Hey folks, Sirdar here for Dev with Sirdar, and in this episode, I'm going to show you how to set up a Python virtual environment in 2023. In Python, a virtual environment, or venv, is an isolated instance of Python. You can use it to separate dependencies for projects from each other, and also from the base Python install that's in your system. Now, a venv can live anywhere, but the ideal place to put it is in a subdirectory of the root of the project that it's meant to support. So here's the basic way to get things set up with a venv. I have here a project directory, and I have a very simple piece of sample code in it. This is just code that creates a window using the piglet library. And to set up the virtual environment, I use this command line. This is for Windows, by the way, py-m venv.env. And this will create our venv in the subdirectory .env, as you can now see. By the way, when you're creating the directory for the venv, my own approach is to use a name with an initial dot as a way to indicate that it's not part of whatever is around it, that it should be treated as something separate and private and so forth. In theory, you can name it anything you like. This is just what I use. Now, once that directory has been created, you don't need to go into it to do anything with it. Don't place project code in the venv directory. Don't place anything in it that doesn't need to be there. Your only interactions with it should be through pip or other tools in the same vein. Now, if you want to use the venv, if you want to actually employ it for our project, then we need to do one of two things. One, if we want to run code with it, we can pass commands directly to the instance of Python in the venv by using the full path. So for instance, if I wanted to run pip list using this venv, I could type this command, env scripts python -m pip list. The thing is that this is a little clumsy because we have to supply the full path to the venv each time we want to run a command like this. So the other option is we can activate the venv. We can set it as the default instance of Python to use for this shell session. And we can do this with a script that's provided when the venv is installed. .env scripts activate. Now notice how when we do this, the command prompt has changed. It indicates that we now have an environment active for this session. So if we type just pip on its own using pip list, that will be routed to this venv's instance of Python. And if we just launch Python, then the venv's instance of Python will be the one that's used. So now I can use pip to install one of the needed dependencies for this project, and I can run this project and have it start using that dependency separate of every other instance of Python that I have running. Now, activating an environment persists in a shell session until you close that shell session. It's not something that's universal. But if you are using an IDE that has Python tooling, like Visual Studio Code here, you can configure the IDE to use the given venv as the default for all the Python work you're doing for that project. Now, for VS Code here, I've got this thing here in the bottom bar that I can click to select a Python instance. And I can have my venv show up as one of the choices. So when I kick open a shell session, a newly created shell session in VS Code for this project, that venv will automatically be activated. By the way, quick tip here for Visual Studio Code users, this auto-activating behavior doesn't actually kick in with a project until the Python add-in is actually running. Basically, until you open a Python file as a signal to the editor that you're using Python. So keep that in mind when you're using VS Code in Python. Now, you can also create multiple virtual environments for a given project. For instance, let's say you want to try out different versions of Python in parallel. They just need to be set up in separate directories. You do need to have any different base versions of Python installed in your system to do this, however. So, example, for this project, I'm going to manually specify that I want to use Python 3.12, which is the one that's currently in beta, to create a new venv. And I'm going to place that in the .env312 directory. And once I've created it, I can now choose between one of those for this project as needed. I should also note that if I change project venvs and I have any open shell sessions, they're still going to be using whatever venv they've already been activated with. I would have to close this shell session and reopen it to use the newly chosen one. Another question that comes up often is, how big does a venv get? Well, when you freshly installed it with no dependencies, it's generally around 10 to 15 megabytes. And it can grow once you start installing packages into it. But You can always store a venv in another place. Let's say you have room on a different drive that you want to use instead of where you're storing your projects. And yes, it is possible to create a venv and share it between multiple projects if they have the same requirements. That said, this is not the best idea. You want to keep each project separate if you can, because each project can have its own drift in terms of what requirements are necessary. And on the whole, disk space is cheap enough that it's worth using the convenience of keeping your project separate. Now, if you move a project folder somewhere else with the venv in it, any venv that you have in there is not really necessarily going to work in the new location. You may have to remove and recreate the venv to make sure it works properly. And this is because when you create a venv, it hard codes certain information about its location into it. This is just part of how it works. Now, finally, what if you want to get rid of a venv and you don't need it anymore? Well, that's easy. You can just delete the venv directory. Anything that used that venv, however, will no longer work. So you're going to have to either recreate it or point to another venv, but there is no formal uninstall process. You can just toss it away when you're done. So that's it for this episode. If you liked it, leave a comment below, and don't forget to follow Dev with Serdar and InfoWorld on Facebook, YouTube, and of course, InfoWorld.com.